This time on Norfolk Perspectives, United Way is going to focus on education and you. We're going to talk about how to keep the holiday safe, an important topic. The Norfolk Youth Council is going to rally up, and you've got a part to play in that. So join us right here on Norfolk Perspectives. Welcome to Norfolk Perspectives. I'm Bob Batcher, and I am joined by a very special guest, Sarah Bishop. Sarah Bishop's with the United Way, and you've been on that sofa before to talk about success by six.
That's correct.
But today we're going to talk about much longer than just 6 years old, right?
That's correct. United Way has had a major focus on school readiness, birth to six, so we called it success by six. But we've been asked by volunteers and by donors and a United Way board to help deal with the issue of dropout rates, kids not succeeding in school. And so now we're looking at education, we call it the big E, from now birth to high school graduation.
Sarah, that's a big goal.
It's a big chunk, but we aren't doing it alone. We've partnered with the schools, with the city, and with housing to see what we could do differently to get different outcomes.
Okay, well, let me back up though, because, we're about that time where you're announcing you've had a very successful campaign. Need more.
Need more always, yes.
But the your success has always been measured by how much money was raised.
Yeah, that's right. For years, we've been measured by, can we meet our financial goal? And can we get that to the agency so they can do their work?
Right. So you get it to the agency, they do the work, problem's fixed.
That's correct. But now the community has said there are some major social problems that we aren't seeing get relieved. And can United Way bring some different people around the table to get different outcomes?
Okay. But Sarah, have you watched the news lately?
Yeah.
I mean, it's overwhelming, isn't it?
It is overwhelming. In the city of Norfolk, we have a lot of kids that come from some tough environments, and they come into wonderful schools, but they still struggle.
Wow. Okay, so silver bullet answer by September, what is it?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I mean, isn't that what people want?
People want a quick answer. They want us to fix it in 90 days. But the answer is going to take a lot of work. It's going to take some different programs, different partnerships. So partnering with the city is a brand new effort with United Way.
Well, in fact, I got to tell you, one of the reasons we're doing this interview is Marcus Jones, the city manager,
yes,
came back from a one-day trip and was kind of tired, but very excited about something he saw there. Tell me about that trip.
We had a marathon trip to Harlem. We took the city manager, the superintendent of schools, and the CEO of housing with us, CEO of United Way, and we went to see what Harlem had done, because Harlem, and if Harlem can do it, Norfolk can. Harlem was seeing an increase in kids' reading scores, math scores, kids staying in school, attendance rates improving, and we went to see what they had done.
Okay, now I can understand taking the superintendent of schools, but why would you take the city manager and the chief operating officer of NRHA with you?
That's the right question, but we found out, looking at national research, that the reason why a lot of kids weren't making it in school, achieving academically, was outside the control of the schools. It was for what we call the after the bell issues. It was for the dysfunction in families, quite frankly, neighborhoods, and the community. So the solutions have to include families, neighborhoods, and the community. And that's why Marcus Jones was there.
Okay, because so often the typical model has been fix the schools, it'll get better.
Yeah.
Fix housing, that can be NRHA's job. Fix the family, human services, or the church.
Yes.
Or more importantly, the family. I mean, see, people have these simple answers.
We all want simple, but it is highly complex. And the one thing is that we all share, it's responsibility for children. So there are a lot of kids who don't have before school opportunities. They're home alone. Kids who go home to an empty house. So can United Way, Parks and Rec, library, and housing provide after-school resources with tutoring and partner with teachers so kids who need to strengthen math scores, kids get the services they need.
Wait a minute, I think I'm hearing something about maybe collaborating?
This is true collaboration. It may also involve shared funding, because right now...
Now, wait a minute. Now, wait a minute. Now you're getting into touchy area, aren't you?
But we've got a very exciting city manager who said on the way back, what would it take to throw some of us upside down, throw it on its head, and do what Harlem did, and say, if we share these kids, we share planning and we share resources.
There was a story that he tells about what the new director of this center faced every morning.
Yeah.
And I mean, it sounds familiar, and she had a creative solution for it, didn't she?
This was an interesting story. A woman who was half my size, half my age, young, attractive woman, who knew that kids were being recruited into drugs and gangs as they were coming in and out of the Harlem Children's Zone. And she typically in the past would have called the police and said, arrest them.
Because that's how it works.
That's how it works. Instead, she went outside and said, hey, I don't want to mess with your business, but can you do me a favor? Can you go do your recruiting on the other block? Or can you have a shift change and do it at the time when kids are not coming to school? Because you're messing with my work, but I don't want to mess with your work. And they start saying, yeah, we got your back. They then started wanting to know what she was doing. Some of those people are now working with her. She couldn't beat them, so she thought, can I infiltrate? Can I join them and get them to join me to support kids?
That story spoke so loudly to me because so often we walk down the street and we put a blinder on and say, what I won't know won't hurt me. But
she
it could be hurting her kids.
Because she knew the kids were facing it.
Okay, but that's one person in all of Harlem, right, that kind of made that change?
No, it was a lot of people.
Ah.
It was housing. It was library. It was Parks and Rec. It was police. It was United Way. It was city planning. It was roads. It was everyone around the table saying, what is the impact of what we are doing? What is it on the family? What is the impact on kids?
So what do we do? What makes the change?
All of us being around the table. It may be that city of Jacksonville, Florida, the mayor got together with the police chief and he said, my crime goes up when you kick kids out of school. Can you stop suspending kids? Can we work with United Way and put different services with the schools so when a kid is suspended, he actually stays in the school building? Because you don't want a kid who's been kicked out of school walking the streets.
But Sarah, you're talking about more work, and we're overworked already. I mean, we were talking
right.
Pre-tape. I mean, some of the parents are working three or four jobs just to kind of put it all together. They're underemployed in those three or four.
We aren't blaming anyone.
Grief.
We're looking at saying, where are we already spending dollars? Where do we already have some resources? Where are there some strengths? I'll give you one number. In the year 2008, the academic year 2008-09, the city of Norfolk Public Schools had more than 4,900 students who were just repeaters. They are kids who failed the year before, and they cost us another $11,000 per student per year to go back in again. Let's take that $11,000 for repeaters that we had to pay in 2008-09, and let's look at what we spent just on repeaters, $53 million. On a group of kids who had to repeat the year. What if we took those dollars and said, let's put it at the front end. Let's look at mentoring. Let's look at tutoring. Let's look at the police being engaged with the $53 million for kids who failed and put it at the front end. Let's support their parents. Let's support after school, but do it in a way that gets real outcomes.
So really not necessarily spending more.
There are no more dollars.
You just hit it on the head.
There are no more dollars.
There would be some that could say that's almost good.
It is good. We've got to change what we're doing. We have to do what Marcus Jones said, the city manager, and say, we're going to turn us on our heads.
What about the one that's listening to this show that says, well, my son or daughter is the grade A student, heading to being valedictorian. This has nothing to do with me. Once I get him or her out of the schools, we're safe. What do you have to say to that parent?
That child is in school with kids who are creating disruption, who need support, who need help, who need mentoring. Your child can't be the only one who gets a job or goes to college. We are all lifted when all children are lifted. No one can be left behind.
And maybe that child that's lifted can also help out.
Absolutely.
I think that's what I, and we're going to have this conversation throughout the year because
good.
I think there are opportunities for people who have opportunity
yes.
to help share, and yet it won't cost another penny.
We've got strengths, and we need to build on each other's strengths. We all have got to chip in.
Wow. That's a message for the holidays.
It's a message.
Sarah, thanks for everything that you're doing
Thank you
to
so
really
much.
Help pitch in, but raise that tide.
It's
so
exciting.
Let's spend the year doing that.
I look forward to it.
And make 2012 the year of celebration. What do you think?
I'm in.
I think we can do it. Let's do it.
Thank you.
Okay. When we come back, we're going to talk about staying safe for the holidays, possibly writing your own home. Stay tuned.
I'm lucky.
Let me help you with that.
I get to do something I love. It has nothing to do with touchdowns or titles.
Everybody bring it in.
I get to play a part in the life of someone just starting out.
How many of you think homework is just as important as teamwork?
I help keep kids in school.
Good.
And that's the name of the game.
My name is LaDania Thomason. I don't just wear the shirt. I live it.
Give. Advocate. Volunteer. Live United.
Welcome back to Norfolk Perspectives. As we heard in the first segment, these are times to start looking at doing things differently, but also being aware of how you can become involved. And these are happy holidays, I think you've heard a lot of people say. But for some, it's a stressful time, and it brings out the worst in people, too. And I've got Captain Steve Duke, who's with the Norfolk Sheriff's Department. How you doing?
Good.
Good seeing you.
Good to see you.
And Investigator Dale Stacey with the Norfolk Police Department. You know, I was a little nervous when I saw I'm going to have both of you guys on the sofa at the same time, but we're going to make this go. The holidays. In your field, what do you think of during the holidays as an investigator with the Norfolk Police Department in domestic violence?
Well, in where we work, we see, you know, that there's a set number of reports that come in every month, and I think there's a misnomer out there that there's more domestic violence reports during the holidays, when it's even. It just stays at about an even flow. In fact, there are other times of the year actually that we see more domestic violence as far as the number of reported incidents to the police department.
Okay, now Steve, this is the time that I always get the guest booked on to talk about making sure all your Christmas packages or your shopping sprees are kept in the trunk and all that kind of crime prevention stuff. It seems easy. But you're dealing with a special audience, aren't you?
I deal a lot with seniors. And now with the holidays being out, everybody's out and about. They're going out shopping. There'll be a lot more people. And we try to teach them to, when they're out and about, be safe, be secure. But most importantly, be aware of your surroundings. Know what's going on around you. Don't look like a victim. If you look like a victim, you probably will be one.
Will become one. Okay, so I'm sensing some themes here. I mean, if you're out and about, no matter what time of year, there's a possibility of crime issues. And you don't necessarily have to be out and about. It could be in your own living room, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
What are some signs that you see that people should be looking for if they've... Well, first of all, is it something you go about talking about?
Well,
if you're a potential victim or a victim?
The potential victim or a victim of domestic violence is not necessarily going to come forward right away when the incidents start occurring. There may be a lot of denial going on. There may be a lot of problems with that victim to where they cannot report. So when they do come to report, they're serious about it. They're profound about it. And if anything needs to be said for the holiday time, it would be that domestic violence during this time can be more intense. While there are not more reports of it than other times of the year, the types of violence may become a little bit more serious. Certainly, people want to talk about alcohol during the holidays, and in talking about alcohol, we know that alcohol doesn't necessarily make domestic violence happen more often. However, it does exasperate it. It does make it a little bit more intense as far as the type of crimes that are committed when under the influence of alcohol.
911 should be a number used, but it shouldn't necessarily be the first number. Are there other avenues besides calling the police?
Well, I think that if a person is dealing with the feelings of domestic abuse and they're wondering whether, in fact, they are a victim, perhaps they should check with some of the hotline numbers that we've availed to this telecast here.
Yeah, because we're going to be running those.
Those two telephone numbers, one of them for the state of Virginia is a 24-hour hotline, and also one for the Southampton Roads area, which is for response. Both of these agencies are very victim helpful as far as being able to guide somebody through some of the signs and some of the symptoms and some of the things that they need to be recognizing as far as domestic violence is concerned. Certainly, in our office, if there are investigators available, they will talk to that end as well. But we find that the state hotline and the response hotline are very helpful to people as far as showing them where they are, in fact, becoming a victim, and they may not quite realize it, but they know something is wrong in that relationship, and they'd like to correct that. So these numbers tend to help.
And those are environments where it's okay to say, I think I'm a victim here.
That's correct.
Now, Steve, you made a comment, though, that if you act like a victim when it comes to going out and about, you might be one. And I know I have some senior friends who have had an incident, their purse got stolen, mm-hmm. and they became really shy about going out.
Oh yeah.
How do you break that kind of?
I don't know. A lot of that's just going to be a mindset of the individual. But what I try to teach them is, accidents do happen, unfortunately. Just hopefully we could learn from it and not let it happen again. And, I also tell them there's no absolutes in life. I wish there was. Mm-hmm. If there was no crime, Dale and I wouldn't have a job. But, I mean, and that's the sad fact of it, but it has to be done. But hopefully by what I do, by going out to, senior groups and civic leagues and whatever, and we try to hammer home the same rules that apply to everybody. I mean, it's not just the holidays. This is something you can use mm-hmm. every day. So hopefully if you are a victim, I hope you weren't injured, but maybe we could learn not to do whatever it was we did or did not do the next time around.
Well, let's talk about that purse snatching.
Okay.
Are the things you should, and I'm not saying you carry a purse, but for those that do, what should they do?
The number one thing that I see all the time is they leave their purses in their shopping carts and walk away from the cart.
Can you say that again?
They leave their purses in their shopping cart, and if you're going to do that, take the little baby thing, that holds the babies in, where you put them in the
front. Yeah.
Lock that, because if somebody's going to try to take your purse, you got it locked. So now you've just caused a distraction.
Okay, now, this is one, I take it very personally, because my wife will get to the grocery store, put it in there, and then give me the cart.
Yeah.
Do that. Don't give it to your husband either, right?
No. I try to tell a lot of people, too, take the least amount of things that you need. If you're going to go out and shop, take one credit card. How many credit cards do you really need?
Right.
And keep it in your wallet or like something in your pocket. I've actually got my mom doing it. She's doing it pretty good, so she doesn't really carry the purse thing a whole lot. At home, keep your doors locked. Make sure you got proper lighting at nighttime. Don't leave your blinds open. It sounds like common sense stuff,
mm-hmm.
but sometimes we just need to take a step back and look at what we're doing or not doing.
Are there some common sense things to look at in domestic violence? Are there signs that you should be looking for that maybe you ought to try to get some help?
Well, while it's not as cut and dry as a crime of property or such as a purse snatching, there certainly are things that can be telltale signs. Obviously, when somebody's in a relationship, notices that they're not having their say, that they're not equal in that relationship, that they're somehow second or somehow being gone around as far as the decisions in the home are being concerned. And then, of course, the possibility of violence. If that seems to be rising, if there seems to be more and more of yelling and screaming and breaking of things, these are all telltale signs that this relationship needs to be looked at a little bit more closely mm-hmm. as far as domestic violence. And certainly some of the people on those hotlines would be able to help the persons that are going through those things.
I'm mainly hearing is look out for yourself, be smart about your environment. Right?
That's true.
And then be willing to ask for help?
Correct.
If you need seniors, look for a companion, right?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. They're great. Especially if you go out. You can actually reduce your risk of being victimized if you go with just one other person in public.
There we go. So look out. Yeah. And really try to focus on having a happy holiday. I guess I'm happy to hear that in both cases, when it comes to your own personal safety out in public, but also domestic situations, that the holidays don't necessarily cause more calls, but it's a matter of being aware of your environment that can help
yes,
prevent that call.
That's correct.
Thanks for everything that you guys are doing to keep our community safe, but more importantly, educating people about how to be safe and secure in their own homes and out in public. When we come back, we'll be talking about that investment in youth and a rally that, yes, you can even participate in. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
How you doing? I just want a regular, no sugar today.
You got it.
Thanks. Hello.
Hi.
Did you make that whole thing today?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hi. How you doing?
She's getting big, huh?
Yeah, she is big. Her haircut.
Yeah.
Yeah. Looks cute. Well, let's go. Nice to see you. Thanks a lot.
If only child abuse were this easy to recognize. If you even suspect abuse, call 1-800-4-A-CHILD. All calls are anonymous and confidential. Trust your instincts.
Welcome back to Norfolk Perspectives. You know, it's talking about security, part of it really becomes the kind of people that look out when you're a youth. And we got two people who are looking out for our youth to provide a secure environment, and that's Clifton Russell, Recreation Supervisor 2 with the Bureau of Youth Services, Recreation, Parks, and Open Space. That in itself is a mouthful that we need to talk about.
Okay.
Dree Sewell is the PR Coordinator for CLEAN, which stands for?
Citizens Educating and Learning About Their Neighborhoods.
Okay, good, because I thought you were going to tell me you have youth that have clean rooms.
We're going to work on that.
Is that what you're working on?
We're working on that as well.
Okay, Clifton, I got to call on you first, because you haven't always been a recreation supervisor, and you haven't always been at our post, and youth services is now in Recreation, Parks, and Open Space.
Yes,
explain that
correct.
To me, please.
Okay, it's just, we used to be the Office of Youth and Childhood Development, and in transition, we now become this new Bureau of Youth Services within Recreation, Parks, and Open Space. It's been a great experience so far.
Because the idea is to really kind of put it all under one area,
yeah,
so we're
absolutely.
Thinking strategically about
yes.
our kids.
Yes.
Have the kids
yeah.
found you?
They found me, yeah.
Okay.
I'm now out of
it. Okay, we were talking in pre-tape, you know, the difference between young at heart and maturity. Okay. We're all young at heart.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
You've been doing this for a long time.
Long time.
Back when you were young.
Yes.
Okay. You've seen some changes?
I've
kind
seen
of what we were
changes.
Talking about with Sarah?
Yes. Yeah. We've seen ages of, we talk about Generation Z and more being a technology.
No, wait a minute. What?
Z is what they call it.
Is that what it is now? Does that mean it's the last generation?
Yeah. It's debatable. But it's a more technology savvy type era, whereas kids are more in gear to online computers, cell phones, that sort of thing. And it's a little bit different than when I was growing up with interacting with friends and things of that nature.
Now, I know that with my kids, if anything goes wrong with a computer, on the phone with my son-in-law, they know how to plug it. That's
absolutely.
Good.
Absolutely.
But Dree, that's not always good, is it?
No, it isn't good. And we have to be able to see that need there. Just to be able to say, okay, they have all of the latest advancements in technology, give it to them, award them whether they need it or not, and put them in front of these things, that's crippling our youth.
Mm-hmm.
That's putting them in a position to whereas they become more at risk, they're beginning to become complacent. And they don't utilize the services and activities that they have out there within their community, people and their liaisons that are partnering together to put on programs and activities for them to be well-rounded individuals that we need for our future. We need our youth to be well-rounded for us.
So you're not just talking about physical well-being.
No.
You're talking about really social skills, too.
Exactly. Within CLEAN in itself, we have so many programs that we collaborate with other child-serving agencies. And what we do is we target them and we say, okay, what are you working with? Is in this example, mm-hmm. CLEAN is partnering with Mr. Russell here. We're working with them for their youth rally and forum that's coming up. Mm-hmm. And we're getting together two different communities and we're getting our youth to go in with them and say, you have education program, there is a mentorship program, a tutorial program, real life programs, all different programs that is going to make you the person that you need to be.
You know, Cliff, something just hit me. About 40 years ago, I heard some of the same stuff.
Yeah.
Maybe, but we tend to get so wrapped up in the new technology, the new approaches.
Yes.
But sometimes maybe just stepping back and being human beings with each other?
Absolutely.
Is that what you're finding?
Yes, absolutely. And this is why, one of the reasons why we have our youth council. And these are young leaders in Norfolk. We want them to really be involved with more things that's going on with their peers in the neighborhoods and in the schools. And so we are in our recruitment stage where we are going to have a junior council for the first time. And those are going to be young people working within their neighborhoods to work on community projects and things that empower them, as well as, you know, making them feel better about their community.
Now, are you, so does that mean you're kind of growing little mini bureaucrats? Or are you growing human beings?
Yeah, human beings.
So what is, okay, does the council meet the first Tuesday of every month?
Yeah, we meet the third Saturday of every month.
Okay.
Right? And that may change. And with the new junior councils that we're hoping to start in January, they'll be meeting twice a week, or twice a month, I should say, at least, in their own communities. And our senior, which is actually our high school youth councils, will act as mentors to them.
I was going to say, because some of the senior people have been around for...
Yes.
Now, are you hearing that they're wanting to do things different? And when I talk about doing it the old-fashioned way, mm-hmm. about bringing human beings together, mm-hmm. but their ideas are different, aren't
they? Yeah, the ideas are a little different.
What kind of ideas are they coming up with?
Well, they're coming up with a lot.
I'm ready.
But believe it or not, being socially accepted and being able to do things in their community, I'm seeing that they are really wanting to be heard. And we want to be that support. We want to be that voice for them, to help them get the word out, to be more a part of what goes on in the community.
And somebody tells me, too, if the viewer were to listen to the kids, they'd be hearing the same thing, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, so tell me about the rally.
Okay, the rally is February 4th at the Norview Community Center, and I partner with CLEAN and Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority's Youth Services, as well as the Children of the Sun. And we want a group of young people to come together and really discuss some issues that may be concerning them in their community or in their schools. And one of my youth council members wanted something to be set up similar to a city council meeting. And so we're going to do that in our own way.
Well, and what is your own way?
Well, we're going to have it so that my youth council will be in the front of the room, and we're going to have two sides of the room geared, mic'd up, and we're going to hear issues, either school or community, and we're going to actually hear from our young people and try to address those issues and do a little breakout sessions as well, to really come up with some answers on what our young people can do in the city of Norfolk.
Cool.
Positive.
Yeah, well, you know, Dree, sometimes I hear from kids, it's that unfiltered, you know, they haven't been around long enough to have a bunch of people tell them, you can't do that, right?
Exactly. And in telling them that they can't do something, that's where we come in, and we partnership with all of the other child serving. I mean, we work with the Norfolk Police Department. We work with the Norfolk Youth Council. Mm-hmm. We work with the fire department, as you said earlier. Our executive director, he makes sure that we even work with the Port Alliance Federal Credit Union. And we look at the students as they come up, and we pay attention to them. And we say, okay, this person is really exemplifying themselves as a well-rounded individual, and we have them especially go to the youth forum.
Super.
We're going to send them and make sure that they're there as a voice to be heard.
Well, thanks for everything that you guys are doing to celebrate our youth. In fact, talking about celebration, we're going to make 2012 the year of celebration right here in Norfolk, and we want to hear from you. But what are different ways that you'd like to see us celebrate, or you are celebrating in the city of Norfolk? Give us a holler at 664-6510. And as usual, it's a wonderful time to be in Norfolk just because of you.